Just remember he'll provide. Keep moving forward. Watching with his shepherd's eye, so just remember he'll provide.
Dark
dark as night. And it's hard to see where this will lead. Don't give up the fight. And when you're feeling like you got nothing left inside, when you're feeling like you got nothing left inside, then you'll know it's time. Then you'll know it's time. Then you'll know it's time. Don't let the fear that turns your feet to stone leave you feeling all alone. Your alibi up in the sky is watching with his shepherd's eye. So just remember he'll provide. Keep moving forward. Just remember he'll provide. And keep moving forward. Keep moving forward. When it's hard, hard to breathe, hard to know which way to go, just how to proceed. And when it's dark, dark as night, it's hard to see where this will lead. Don't give up the fight. And when you're feeling like you got nothing left inside, when you're feeling like you got nothing left inside, then you'll know it's time. Then you'll know it's time. Then you'll know it's time. Don't let the fear that turns your feet to stone leave you.
Good morning, Hope Community Church family. Nice to see you guys today. There is no better place to be than right here, right now, as we worship together and lift up His name. But good to see you guys. As we go to prayer, we always like to pray for a different ministry in the area. God's Divine Purpose Church, Pastor John Miller. Let's pray for him and their efforts in reaching others for Jesus Christ. We want to pray for those who are sick and not well. We want to continue to pray for Norm. Had his surgery. Things are doing well. he's recuperating, Buffalo Crossing. I want to continue to pray for Louise as well. And let's pray for Nikki. Nikki is not doing so well, and we heard that there are some other stuff that might be going on that they need to take a look at. But let's go to prayer and trust the Lord that he would watch over us as we worship him today in spirit and in truth. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for your goodness and your mercies towards us. We thank you for this week that you have watched over us. Even at those times, oh God, that when we were not so mindful that you were right there, but then we realized that had it not been for your presence and for you slowing us down or causing us to stop, that things probably would have gone a lot worse. We thank you. We praise you. Thank you for our church family today, for every single one of us, those who are here. They have come to church this morning with various needs, and we just pray and ask, oh God, that you would meet all of those needs according to your riches in glory. I pray especially for that family who may be going through some serious issues at this time. You know them all, and we bring them all before you, and we thank you. And we praise you. I pray that you would be with Pastor John Miller and their efforts in reaching others for Christ. Touch them, we pray, and help that through their ministry that many will come to know Christ as the Lord and personal Savior. We pray for Kirsten that you would continue to touch her and continue to bring healing and her body. Watch over Norm. Watch over Louise, watch over Nikki today. And we just claim healing and victory in the name of Jesus. We thank you, we praise you. Be with Pastor Don as he will come and share the word. I pray, oh God, that you, your Holy Spirit would anoint him, the words that he speak, find roots in our hearts. Be with our worship team today as they blend their voices together in worship, in songs, in scripture. Warm our hearts as they do that. We thank you and we praise you. And as we are being faithful stewards to you today, bless us with our gifts as we give unto you, and we shall give you all the praise and all the thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I am glad that you are a part of this time to be together to worship. And I'm thankful that you guys are here in the summertime. So let's stand together. Our God is awesome.
Say good.
good morning, neighbor. Give them a big high five. High five to your neighbor. High five them. Woohoo! And if our God is for us, who then could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then who could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then who could stand again? Stand again. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are high. God is the healer. He's awesome.
Worship. Thou art exalted far above all, O God.
Sing it again for that one.
Thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all God. Thou, O Lord,
let your voice and sing.
Art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above. For showing us your love, your mercies. Lord, thank you for our freedom to be able to worship you, to exalt the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Lord, prepare our hearts for your word in your name. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. We're not going to dismiss the kids yet because we have a video in a few minutes, and it's going to be, they're going to want to watch it. So, good morning. I'm Barb, volunteer here at Hope Community Church. I'm also Pastor Don's wife, and I'm so excited to be here this morning. Thank you for joining us. When you came in the door, you should have received a program. Looks like this. If you did not get one, please raise your hand. We'd love to bring you one. Somebody will bring, we've got several hands. Keep your hands up so Pastor Don can see you. At the bottom of the program is a connection card. It tears off on perforated paper like this. We like for every person to fill one out every single week. Pastor Don, up here too. Okay, so this is a connection card, which means that's our way for us to connect with you and for you to connect with us. So just, if you're a first-time guest, just fill out as much as you feel comfortable and take that to the welcome table afterward. We have a gift for you. We like to welcome our guests by giving them a gift. It's a privilege for you to be here with us this morning. We have a book for you. We have some information about our church. And we have some lip balm with SPF 15 because we live in Florida and we like our sunshine and we like our lip balm. So please stop by the welcome table if you are with us for the first time today. You can put those in the blue box if you're a regular. We do like to connect with you. Also, it's kind of fun to be able to have all the announcements on the back and take notes if you want to. So on the back does change every week, so you can turn it over and follow along with me if you'd like. We are checking in on Facebook, so if you are still old enough to have a Facebook account, please check in, because for every check-in, we donate a dollar somewhere. This month, we are donating to Souls for Souls, and Souls for Souls takes all these shoes that we've been collecting all month, and they take all the shoes that they collect from around the world and they repurpose them. So they may repair them so that somebody can have shoes to wear, or they might repurpose them into some other thing. So they take all kinds of shoes. It doesn't matter if you have six holes in them because they might not repair those, but they might do something else with them, which is pretty stinking cool, I think. So we're going to be sending all your shoes off to Souls for Souls, and then it costs them money to get them where they need to be. And so we are also donating money to them this month for that purpose. On Sunday, next Sunday, we're going to have a church-wide potluck at 5 o'clock. This we started this last year, and it was a grand success, and so it was so much fun. We you know, on Sunday mornings, you all sit that direction and face us, but on these types of events, we get to kind of sit around tables and get to know each other a little bit, so we encourage that. So we will be having connection groups again that start up in September, but for now, we want to have a potluck. So if you are coming, sign up at the welcome table. If you're willing to bring a dish, just kind of put what type of dish you're bringing. We're not real picky about the whole thing, but if you, that's at 5 o'clock next Sunday. Everybody's welcome. After the potluck, we're all going to get in our vehicles. We're going to go over to Wildwood Middle High School, and we're going to have a back-to-school prayer. Again, something that we've been doing countywide. I don't even know, is it a nation type thing? I don't know. It's back-to-school prayer day, and there will be churches at every school in the area at 7 o'clock next Sunday, and we will be at Wildwood Middle High School. Please come out. There will be other people there, too. So we invite the staff. We invite the administration. We invite all the kids, everybody. And so there's going to be some people. I think this year it's going to be inside. Is that right, Pastor? So we will not be sweating to death like we have the past couple years. We have asked them to open the gym for us. We will be inside. So we'll head over there at 7 o'clock to begin our back to school prayer. As these kiddos go back to school, we want to cover them in prayer. The men's breakfast has been moved. It's typically the first Saturday of the month, not August. So don't show up here on Saturday. It's going to be on the 10th. So that is at 8:30 in the morning on August 10th, men's breakfast for any man and any person, guy. You don't have to be a certain age. It's men. Okay. Are you interested in learning how the Jewish teachings relate to Christianity? Then join us for Hayesod, did I say it right? Yes, it only took me like 18 weeks to learn how to say it. Foundation. It's a 10-lesson program focused on understanding the Jewish underpinnings of Christianity, the people, the land, and the Torah, and establishing them as the bedrock of discipleship to Jesus. So that is going to be starting on August 11th after church around noon, and it's going to go until about 1:30. So Kimberly, wave your hand. Kimberly, she's in the back. She's your contact. Please touch base with her because she needs to order books if you would like to join us on that. Okay, I think I've gotten all the announcements in. So quick reminder, you can give to the church by texting 352-444-1771. You could put your offering in the blue box next to the door, or you can give through our portal on our website. We hope you find the service relevant. Stay after for pastries and coffee, and we're going to have a little video.
So simple, faith like a child. I give you an inch and you take me a mile. I feel the wind rush and the thunder roll. 2 feet on the water, only one way to go. Yeah. I don't gotta be afraid no more, no. Cause I know you up through the storm. I'm more than just a talker.
Oh, Thanks. All right. And if you're going to Kids Zone, this would be the time to do that. And by the way, that was VBS, and we've partnered with First Baptist Church of Oxford with that last couple years, and we've done some other things with them, and it's been a good partnership. So we're going through a sermon series through the book of Jeremiah, and I got about three more sermons through Jeremiah. There's a whole bunch of other chapters, but I'm not sure if you guys want to hear, like, the letter to the Egyptians, and then the letter to they're all about the same, like God saying, okay, I'm going to punish you for doing this. But so I got about three more sermons through the book of Jeremiah. And I want to start out by telling you about a race last year. So on July 4th, 2023, Olympic runner Sinberi Tafari, she was the defending champion of the Petrie Road Race. That's her up in front in Atlanta, Georgia. She was leading the 10K race. She led pretty much the whole way, and she's within meters of the finish line here. And the banner's in sight. She's got the banner in sight, the finish line's in sight. But there was a motorcycle cop in front of her that kind of follows you through the course. I've never seen them the times I've run. I just try to stay behind the guy with the broom. But there's a motorcycle cop that leads the race, and then right at the end, because he doesn't drive through the finish line, he pulls off. Well, she was following this guy, and somewhere in the race, she got a little confused, and you could see her veering off, and she followed the motorcycle cop off the race, and she realized her mistake, but you see those two ladies behind her. They finished in front of her. She finished in third place, and the mistake cost her $10,000 cash prize. So, yeah, that's a rough day. Just like right there at the end. Well, we're in Jeremiah 31 today, and by the time we get there, it's clear Israel had been running in the wrong direction for a long time, not just the closing meters of the race. They'd been running the wrong direction before the gun was fired. I mean, think about, you know, Moses is coming down from the mountain with the Ten Commandments, and they'd already broken the first two. I mean, hey, guys, gun hasn't even gone off here, and you're running in the wrong direction. And they continued. They repeatedly broke the covenant. So at this point in Jeremiah 31, the city walls are down. Whatever authentic worship is left has been completely disrupted. Jerusalem is desolate, and the people have been carried off into exile. And much like the lady running the race there, Israel was not going to finish as they had planned. They're not even finishing third, by the way. So beyond veering off the course, they broke the terms of the covenant. It's like you ran an illegal race the whole time. You didn't follow the rules. And if you think about this as a historical moment, God's people are carried off into exile. The temple has been raided. I just imagine all of hell must have been smiling. All of hell must have been looking at that. And saying, okay, God's plan was to use this nation to bless all the nations of the world. And it appears to be game over at this point. It appears that they have veered off course. And they're playing a game here. And it looks like don't pass go. Do not collect your 10K. No gold medal. No participation ribbon. Off to exile, disqualified. That's what it looks like in this moment. And the writer of Hebrews, and we will go to Jeremiah 31 after this, but the writer of Hebrews tells us this. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely. You ever notice that? It clings so closely. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Looking to Jesus. You got to focus on Jesus. Somebody else is going to veer you off course, all right? need to go back to Jesus, the founder and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. So God has a course for us to run. God has a course for your life. He has directions. He has a path, and we are to look to Jesus to figure out how to run that course. Now, maybe some of you can relate to Israel. You've been weighed down. You've gotten off course. You don't have to show of hands, but I'll do mine. You ever gotten off course? Yes, right here, this guy. I've run off the course. There's times, yeah. Did you say this week? Sometimes we start to follow something other than Jesus. And sometimes it's fairly innocent. Like this lady is like, I think that she lost focus for that 1 second. Or maybe you're like this guy. That guy. You're like, you guys are running a race? I didn't even know we were in a race. Yeah, you're in a race. Jesus is the author. He's the perfecter of your faith. And we need to follow him. So let's go back historically here. This is a really dark moment. I don't know why I decided to preach through Jeremiah. There's like some really bad moments in there. And maybe it's because that's life, right? Like there are hard moments. There are difficult moments. There are times in my own life where I'm like, I'd rather be doing anything than what's in front of me right now. But there's this dark moment in Israel's history. And in this moment, God speaks through Jeremiah, and he delivers this game changer. Like everything's bleak. And God delivers what I think is the most profound promise imaginable. And this passage will later, it'll become the longest Old Testament passage quoted in the New Testament when we get to Hebrews chapter 8. So the New Testament writers said, hey, this is important. Let's quote this in its fullness. Now, I want to invite you to do something. Those of you who have been around, I've invited you to do this through this whole series. Use your imagination. Use your imagination. I want you to imagine being in Babylon. I mean, think about the situation of those who are getting the letter. I mean, it's not like, oh, cool, we get a letter from Jeremiah. Life's been good. What other blessing does he have for us? No, you are in exile. And if you're in Babylon, you've lost everything. I mean, other than what you carried out of Jerusalem, you have lost everything. There's no temple to worship at. The temple back in Jerusalem is a wreck at this point. And your expectations of anything good happening in your lifetime, probably not real high. Or even the nation of Israel. You got to be looking, going, God, where are these promises? You were going to make us this great nation, and we're going to bless all the other nations, and we're over here in Babylon. You know, well, let's see what God has to say in this, what I would think would just be an all-time low moment in their lives. So I'm going to read what God has to say. Jeremiah 31, beginning at verse 31. So here you are. You got the clothes on your back, some family members and a few items, and you get this message. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant. This first time, new covenant is mentioned. Make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant I made with their fathers on the day I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant that they broke, they went off, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each one his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sins no more. So this morning, I want to do a couple things as we go through this. I want to answer a couple questions, like, Like, what is a covenant? What does that mean? And what are the promises of this new covenant as told by Jeremiah? And why is it important? Well, let's start with that one. Why is it important? This is important because this isn't just an ancient story. You know, we're not just reading some history book about some people that wandered around the desert, found some land, got kicked out of it. This is my story. This is your story. It's a story that God is telling, and he invites you to this. And there's a great question that's answered in there of what's the hope for people who perpetually run in the wrong direction? I don't know if that's any of you, but I've had those moments. Probably had some this week where I run off course. And what is my hope in that? What is the hope for those who run off course? And some of us just fall down, right? You're like I can't even move. I'm not even going forward anymore. What's my hope? All right, so we're going to look at that. What's a covenant? Well, covenant is kind of like a contract. It's a binding agreement between two parties. And in biblical times, they would do something that I think most of us would find weird. If people made a covenant, they would cut an animal in half, and the two parties would walk through those two animals that are cut in half, and they would say, if I break this, may I be like this animal? That's pretty serious stuff, you know. Usually I sign stuff, they say, yeah, we're going to come collect this if you don't, you know, do this. But it's like, no, we're going to cut you in half if you don't do this. And Genesis 15 has an example of that. And people in Jeremiah's day they would understand this. It would not be strange to them. In fact, let me just read a passage, Jeremiah 34:18. And God says, and the men who transgressed my covenant and did not keep the terms of the covenant they made before me, I will make them like the calf they cut in two and pass between its parts. So they would, when they hear covenant, they'd be like, oh, yeah, you cut this animal, you walk through, and you make a pretty serious oath, I would think. And is that strange to most people here? Okay, good, because we need to have a whole nother conversation if it's not strange. Now, rather than me going through, and I think there's some reasons behind the practice, but let's just say that's serious business, right? We can look at that and go, okay, I don't get it, but I understand this is serious. I need to pay attention here. It's kind of like the one time when I went whitewater rafting, and the guy says, when the boat goes over and you hit your head on rocks, you know, and he's talking, and he says, I'm going to tell you how to avoid. And I said, he said when. He did not say if. And so all of a sudden, I just started listening up. I'm like, this is serious. Well, apparently this is serious. And what do I do? Because I tend to run the wrong way. Lord, help me out in this covenant thing. Well, let's look at, I want to look at some of the promises of the new covenant. There's a guy named Philip Ryken. He gave 7 promises. I stole 6 of them, which I think I've told you guys before. It was great when I got to grad school and I found out if I tell you who I stole something from, I'm a scholar. If I don't tell you, it's plagiarism. I'm like, man, I wish I knew this in school, because it's like, how did you get that answer? I took it off of Billy's paper. but let's walk through. So the first promise that we have here of the new covenant, it is a promise of reconciliation. It will bring all of God's people together in one redeemed race. That's an incredible promise. The prophet Joel talks about the new covenant. He says, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. So Jew and Gentile. Jeremiah 31:31 says, behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, while I make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It's really important that he says both, because this is not like an Israel-Babylon issue. Right? Think about it historically, if you didn't know this, the nation of Israel, God says, These are the one people I'm going to show the world what it means to be in relationship with me. They're divided. They are divided. And God says, I'm going to make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. So I'm gonna bring about some reconciliation here. And this deep division, we have evidence. It goes all the way up into the new covenant. When Jesus comes, it's still a divided people group. And this promise of reconciliation is fulfilled when Jesus comes. When Jesus comes on the scene, the New Testament puts it this way in Galatians 3:28. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. And there is no male or female, for you are all one in Christ. Which is just absolutely powerful when you think of the church. Because God tells us that he's going to redeem people from every tribe, every tongue, every nation. And when you look out and you see division in our world between rich and poor, black and white, male and female, let me suggest something. These are not primarily social or political issues. These are theological issues. These are theological issues. Do we believe in the better promises of Jesus, or do we believe in the promises of our latest echo chamber? Because we serve a God of reconciliation, and we have been given the ministry of reconciliation. We're to go out and live as reconciled people to God and one another. We're to demonstrate to the world what it looks like to be reconciled to God. People should look at the church and go, that's what it looks like. That's what it looks like to be people from every tribe, every tongue, every nation. Secondly, the new covenant is a covenant of regeneration. Scientifically, regeneration is the formation of a new animal or plant tissue. And look at this promise that God gives. He says, this is awesome, I think. Verse 33, he says, For this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them. God's going to do some surgery here, it looks like. I'm going to put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. So it's not like God looked in and goes, yeah, the Ten Commandments, those weren't good. I need to do something different here. It's not like that God scraps the old covenant and says, yeah, that was bad. The law is good, right? The law tells you what's right, tells you what's wrong. And so God doesn't scrap what's good. He changes the location. He changes the position. He says, I'm not just going to have that on stone. He's like, I'm going to take that and I'm going to transfer that. And for redeemed people, I'm going to write that on their hearts. If you're a follower of Jesus, you're part of the new covenant, you have a new heart. God wants to do a work from the inside out. And 2 Corinthians 3:3, we're told this, and you show that you are a letter from Christ delivered to us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human hearts. How incredible that God would put his law within our hearts rather than on stone. Third thing is the new covenant is a covenant of belonging. I think most people want that. People want to belong. People want to go somewhere where everybody knows their name, right? And he writes this, and he says, I will be their God, and they will be my people. Isn't that an incredible promise? I mean, the creator of the universe says, I'll be your God, and you will be my people. God says to those who put faith in him that they can claim, you can claim me as your God, and I will call you my people. The apostle Peter, he would write later than this writing, in 1 Peter 2, 9, and 10, he says, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Yeah, I'm in the back of that race in darkness. I don't know where the finish line is, but he calls me out of that. He says, you were once not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. And what's wild about this writing, I'm guessing this just like rocked people's world when Peter wrote this, because it's not written primarily to a Jewish audience, but he's picking up promises that were to the Jewish people. You have this diverse group of people that belong to God and they belong to one another. And Peter says, you, Jew and Gentile, are now a holy nation. I'm sure people's heads exploded when they heard this. And we need to understand here, this nation that he's talking about here has no political, has no geographical, has no ethnic boundaries. It's called the church. Right? And the church, this nation that he's going to work through is to go out to all the nations, all the, in the Greek, the ethnos, people from every tribe, every tongue, every nation, and tell them this good news. Tell them that God can be your God. You can belong to God. You've been invited to the covenant. The new covenant will complete the task of evangelization. This is a really cool verse here. It says, verse 34, it says, and no longer shall they teach his neighbor and each to his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least to the greatest, declares the Lord. So now this is a future promise. There will be that day where people from every tribe, every tongue, every nation, they're going to gather before God. And on that day, you wouldn't have to walk around on that day and go, hey, do you know Jesus? Do you know the Lord? They're like, yeah, I'm standing here. I know the Lord. We won't have to do that. Now, that's not the current reality. Because do you know people that don't know the Lord? Okay, same here. But in Christ, the future has invaded the present. Okay? In Christ, the future has invaded the present. If you are a follower of Jesus, you have the Holy Spirit of God in you, you have a foretaste of what it's going to be like. You have that experience of knowing God as your Father. And we know that one day, that transformation that has happened and is happening in your life, God's going to do that throughout all of creation. God says, I will make all things new. You have a foretaste of that. Now, until that day, we have a task. We have a task to go out and share the good news. Good news, you can be reconciled to God. Good news, hey, you run off course? Yeah, so do I. You know what? Jesus has brought us back in. Okay, number five, the new covenant is a satisfaction for sin. Second part of verse 34 says, I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sin no more. Anybody rejoice in that one? Yeah. I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sin no more. This might be the greatest part here. There's a reason why we run in the wrong direction. It's called sin. You and I have a sin problem. And because of Jesus' sacrifice, his resurrection, our sin problem has been dealt with on the cross. My past, your past, present, future sin has been nailed to the cross at Calvary. And there's something really cool about this new covenant. It's not dependent upon us. It's not dependent like where God's like, okay, you follow every rule along that course. You finish here, number one, and you're in. It's dependent upon Christ. It's dependent upon Christ and his faithfulness. Christ is the one that runs and doesn't grow weary. Christ is the one with clean hands and a pure heart. Christ is the one that the Bible says he made him to be no sin made him to be sin, who knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him, which is like a really great exchange where it's like he runs that race, and you're like, yeah, I'm with him. I'm with him. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't have a race to run, and it doesn't mean that I'm never going to sin again. I won't even ask if you've experienced that. Not this side of eternity, okay? This side of eternity, that doesn't mean we never sin again. But you know what it does mean? It means the pressure's off. The pressure's off. I'm free to follow and love God. Not so, okay, if I do this, God's going to accept me. If I do this, God's going to say, man, you ran a great race. Come on in. Enjoy eternity with me. I don't want to be judged on that merit, okay? I don't want to be judged on the merit of how I ran that race. I want to be judged on the merit of how Jesus ran that race. And me saying, surrendering to him and saying, from this day forward, I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to follow the one that ran the race. The one that finished the course. But what do I do with sin in my life? Because I'm going to guess most of you would say, yeah, I occasionally sin. Confess it. Confess it. Lord, I ran off course today. Lord, I intentionally followed that motorcycle. I knew the finish line was over here, and I intentionally ran over here. We confess that. We bring that before him, and we say, Lord, I'm thankful. You died on the cross. You took my sin. You took my shame. And then you know what we do with that? We walk in forgiveness. And here's something we sometimes forget. When we're forgiven, you know what we can do? Extend that to others. Act like we've experienced forgiveness and extend it to others. Lastly, the new covenant is of endless duration. It goes on forever. Jeremiah puts it this way, beginning at verse 35, Jeremiah 31. Thus says the Lord, who gives the sun for light by day and fixed order of the moon and the stars for light at night, who stirs up the sea so that the waves roar. In other words, he's given his resume here. The one who hung the stars, the one who put everything into motion, he's now talking. The Lord of hosts is his name. If this fixed order departs from before me, declares the Lord, then shall the offspring of Israel cease from being a nation before me forever. Thus says the Lord, if the heavens above can be measured and the foundations of the earth below can be explored, then I will cast off all offspring of Israel for what they have done, declares the Lord. Jeremiah 32:40 says, I will make with them an everlasting covenant. Everlasting, that's a long time. Everlasting covenant that I will not turn away from doing good to them. Here's God's promise. I'm not going to turn away. I will not turn away from doing good for you, and I will put the fear of me in their hearts that they may not turn from me. Now, why is this everlasting? It's not because of me. It's not because of you. It's not a contract just between me and God. It's a contract. It is a blood bond between the Father and the Son on our behalf. Okay? Jesus does for us what we cannot do for ourselves. And we enter this covenant through Christ. And how do we do that? We do that by faith. We say, okay, by faith, Jesus, I receive what you did for me on the cross. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. And Lord, I'm going to live out the rest of my days in faith following you. You are the author and the perfecter of my faith. And these promises, These are the promises of the new covenant for those that are in Christ. And so how do I get into this? I get into this by being in Christ. Let me close in prayer. Father, thank you for these incredible promises that you would take your law and you would write that on our hearts. And so I pray today, Lord, that we would be a people of faith. That today, each one of us here would profess, Lord, we've run off course. But Lord Jesus, you died for our sins, died for our shame, for our guilt. You died on a cross so that we could enter into this new covenant with you. And so today, Lord, we proclaim that you are Lord, you are Savior of our lives. And Lord, we seek to follow you by faith all the days of our life. We love you. We thank you for these incredible promises. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Have you come to the end of yourself?
cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found. Tell the world of the treasure you found. I think that's our commission, our point, where we're going. And if we do veer, we follow something else that's not God's path. We can come to Him and say, Lord, forgive me. Let me follow You. Let's make that our prayer. Lord, I pray, Father God, that You would direct us in Your perfect way. Lord, that You would realign us with Your path. Lord, that You would show us Your new mercies today, Father God. Lord, I pray that this church would be a changed church, a changed people. Lord, that would ignite this community. That would tell the world of the treasure that they found. Lord, I thank You for our pastor and for Pastor Zeph and Pastor Don and Barb. And Father God, I just pray that You would just continue to pour out Your fresh covenant upon us. Lord, thank You for Your love. Thank You for Your Holy Spirit here this morning. Lord, protect us as we go. In Your name we pray. Amen. Love you guys. Look forward to seeing you back here next week.